Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon when you are watching this video lecture. After completing the discussion on three heads of incomes, salaries, income from house property and profits and gains of business or profession or PGBP, let us move on to next and fourth head of income, that is capital gains. Today let us discuss about some of the basic aspects and concepts of capital gains. Then we will enter into the core provisions related to these capital gains and different types of situations that can be encountered under this chapter in the upcoming classes. But before going to the core aspects of this head of income, first let us understand the concept of capital gains, which is also once again a bit of logical situation. Simply speaking, what can be a capital gain on a logical basis? When there is a sale of an asset, so sale proceeds will be there. Sale proceeds, naturally, that will be taxable under the Income Tax Act. But whatever the original purchase price or cost of acquisition of that asset, if you can deduct it from the sale proceeds of the asset, whatever we get is capital gain. In a nutshell, the essence of this entire chapter is that simple, wherein we all just need to identify the sale proceeds, which can also be called as full value of consideration. Then the costs that are related to the acquisition of the asset or improvement of the asset, or even the costs which are all related to the transfer of the asset, can be deducted from that as deductions. Naturally, the remaining will be either gain or loss, which will be the final taxable amount. So the essence of this chapter is very simple in this conceptual understanding. Just like essence of PGBP is all about revenues minus expenses, that is equal to profit or loss, which is taxable. Same logic here also. But the question is, how to find out full value of consideration, how to find out cost of acquisition under different circumstances. First of all, when can we say that the head of capital gains is attracted? Why capital gains as a head of income will be applicable to a particular SSE, under what circumstances, and most importantly, the unique nature of this head of income is this has two types of incomes. Normally, when we have salaries, that is salaries, income under the head of salaries, that's it. Income from house property, that's it. Profits and gains of business or profession, that's it. Only difference in profits and gains of business or profession is that if at all that business is a speculative business, then those profits have to be calculated separately. If it is not a speculative business, all those PGBP related to a non-speculative businesses can be all treated as one and the same, with once again the exceptions related to the carry forward and set off provisions only, like specified business, etc. Keeping that apart, normally there is only one PGBP. There are no two types of PGBPs. Except for set off carry forward purposes, when we look at the normal taxability, PGBP is PGBP, that is either business income or professional income, called as PGBP. Salaries is salaries. Income from house property is income from house property. But capital gains is not just capital gains. Why? Because capital gains itself will have two types of categories. One is short-term capital gain. Second one is long-term capital gain. We have to specify in any particular case whether a particular type of capital gain is short-term or long-term, without which, just by mentioning capital gains, we are missing the answer in its precision. So that is the first and foremost unique feature of this head of income, capital gains. It has two different types within itself. So within this head only, there are two different types of incomes. One is short term, second one is long term. Now, when can we say that certain income is taxable under the head of this capital gains? Naturally, like any other head, there will be charging section. For example, charging section for the head of salaries was section 15. Charging section for income from house property was section 22. Charging section for PGBP was section 28. Similarly, charging section for capital gains is section 45. 45 is enough. That is the charging section or basis of charge, we can say. So when a particular gain or profit will be treated to be taxable under the head of capital gains, we have to understand the definition and basis of charge very well in relation to any chapter, and same is the case with this chapter also. What is the charging section of capital gains? What it says? It says any profits or gains arising from the transfer of what? A capital asset when it was affected, naturally during the previous year, shall be chargeable to income tax under the head of capital gains, and it shall be deemed to be the income of the previous year in which the transfer took place. So the year in which the transfer took place, that will be the year in which the gain or loss resulting from such transfer will be taxable under this head. But once again, we have to keep in mind, when we say the word gain, that includes loss also. That is always natural for any head of income. This head of income also is the same. We say gain, we say profits, but that does not mean it is only positive. Resultant could be plus also, minus also, depending upon the actual situation. But when can we say that a particular income is taxable under this head? First of all, there should be a capital asset. Second, that capital asset should have been transferred. And third, that transfer should have happened during the previous year. Each word is important here. Each word is defined also very well here in this head of capital gains. So we should know, first of all, what is a capital asset. Once we know what is a capital asset, we should also be able to classify them into long-term capital assets and short-term capital assets. That is one thing which is definitely very core aspect related to this head of income. But once we know that, we should also identify what is called as a transfer and what is not regarded as a transfer. So what is a transfer is a discussion. Separate provision is there for that. What is not a transfer is also a separate discussion. For that, there is another provision for transactions not regarded as transfer. For each of them, there is a lots and lots of explanation that is given in this head of income, capital gains. So we need to look into these terms very closely and carefully. Of course, under normal circumstances, just like any other head of income, whatever the event which is the taxable event, that should happen during the previous year. In other words, normally for salaries to be taxable, it should be earned during the previous year or received during the previous year. One of them should happen. In order to tax income from house property, that house property should be there under the ownership of the SSE during the previous year, of course with certain exceptions. Same way, profits and gains of business or profession will be taxable if the business is actually conducted during the previous year, of course with some exceptions. Same way, capital gains also will be taxable in the previous year in which the transfer takes place. Of course, here also there will be exceptions. We will come to the exceptions part later. But in general, the transfer should have happened during the previous year. And the transfer of what? The transfer of capital asset. So naturally, what is capital asset becomes very important in order to first determine the scope of this head of income, capital gains. Imagine if a particular asset is not a capital asset. Simply, it is not coming under the purview of capital gains head at all. It is outside the purview because it is not even a capital asset. That means it will not be taxable. Even if it is transferred also, it will not be taxable. So, what is a capital asset becomes a very important point and definition. So, let us look at that definition. You don't need to remember the definition sections generally, but you have to understand and remember the contents of the definitions. So what is a capital asset? Let us see. Capital asset means, so look at this here, it is not an inclusive definition, it is an exhaustive definition. It is clearly meaning that capital asset means. Means this only, that's all. You cannot add anything as capital asset more than this. So that is why when it is already said as means, in the definition they have mentioned a very broader term. What was that? Property of any kind held by the SSE, whether or not connected with the business or profession. Then what is left? If you say property of any kind, whether or not it is there on the earth, then also it is same. Whether it is on the earth also, whether it is not there on the earth also, still it is capital asset. So whenever you say whether or not, automatically it is covering almost everything. But of course, that is generally called as property. What people will try to think? Property, they think house property. No, property is a generic word. House property is a very specific word which was used in the head of income, that is income from house property. That is different. Here we are talking about property of any kind. It's very open. When the definition started with means, we thought it is going to be very exhaustive definition. But when the definition is actually given, that all hope got evaporated, because the definition itself says property of any kind held by the SSE, whether it is related to the business of the SSE or not, whether it is related to the profession of the SSE or not, irrespective of that, property of any kind is called as a capital asset. Open-ended word, that is property. And any securities held by a foreign institutional investor which has invested in such securities in accordance with SEBI regulations. In general, one more point we have to identify in this chapter of capital gains. This has a lot of practical implications, particularly related to the activities in the capital markets, including foreign investors, mutual funds, amalgamation, demerger, all big things will be there in this chapter. But in spite of that, usually for our problems purposes, numerical questions, these things will not be that much relevant or important. Why? Because normally who will be our SSE? Generally an individual, in general. So this foreign institutional investors is a big thing. Somebody who is an investor, that to a foreign investor, that to an institutional investor. So somebody like a big foreign established mutual fund or something like that, which has invested in the securities in accordance with the SEBI regulations, that securities are called as capital assets also. Practically, there is no much relevance to it for us. So you just need to forget about this, not required to really focus on such items. Even if this definition is not there also, we would have anyway thought that it is a capital asset. Securities is a capital asset, definitely shares are capital assets. Whether it is held by domestic investors or FIIs, what differentiation common sense wise we will make? We will not make any differentiation. Somebody would have gone to court some foreign institutional investor saying that this is not taxable because I am a foreign institutional investor and you don't have purview on me. Like that somebody would have told. So they wanted to just keep everybody under control. So they said, without having any confusion, so as to clarify, even the securities which are held by the foreign institutional investors are also capital assets. That's it. But most important point is, normally everything and anything what is a property of any kind held by the SSE is a capital asset. So that is a difficulty. If definitions are like this, we will never be able to find out whether something is a capital asset or not. But don't worry about it. That is why it is not an inclusive definition, it is an excluding definition. They never used the word includes. They said property of any kind. Now they are telling, but does not include following. So it's a kind of negative list. These things which are mentioned below are not capital assets, which in other words, other than them, everything else is capital asset. So naturally, we don't have to remember what is the definition of capital asset by itself, because it is useless for us. What we have to remember is what capital asset does not mean. What capital asset definition does not include. That is more important. Anything and everything beyond this is a capital asset. So, what is the exclusions list from the definition of capital asset? That is a very important list this we should remember. First thing first, stock in trade. We know this already. Stock in trade cannot be a capital asset. If a particular person sells an asset in the normal course of business, that becomes his stock in trade. And when he sells that, whatever the revenue that he generates, naturally that will be taxable under the head of PGBP. It has nothing to do with capital gains, because stock in trade itself is not a capital asset. Second, personal effects are not capital assets. Personal effects are not capital assets. Like what? Movable properties. Personal effects here do not mean immovable properties. My house is my personal effect. No, not that. The definition of personal effect means movable properties held for personal use by the SSE or any member of his family dependent on him. So any movable property which is used for personal purposes by the SSE cannot be called as a capital asset. Of course, this personal effects includes wearing apparel also and furniture also. Just for clarification, why is that? We will come to it later. Because when we say personal effects, those are movable properties. Furniture is a movable property. Wearing apparel, cloths and all are movable properties. Those are all personal effects. But those are not the only personal effects. Any movable property held for personal use by the SSE or any member of the family of the SSE will be not a capital asset, which automatically means there is no capital gain taxable if any sale of personal effects happens and some gain is actually earned by the SSE. That is not taxable under the head of capital gains at all, because it is not even a capital asset. That is what is an exception to the list of or definition of capital asset. Personal effects is one of such exceptions. But now that personal effects is the word that we are looking at, now let us also see what are the assets which are not treated as personal effects and hence they are capital assets. In other words, exception to exception. Naturally, that is inclusion. Exclusion from an exclusion is an inclusion. What was the original definition of a capital asset? Property of any kind. What is exception to that? Personal effect. What is exception to the personal effects? The following. Which means the following are the exception to the exception, which automatically means the following are capital assets. What are those? Very important first one. That is, jewelry is not a personal effect according to capital gains head, not according to reality. Really, jewelry is personal only now? Of course it is personal only, but according to the definition of personal effects, jewelry is excluded from the definition of personal effect, which means that is a capital asset. If somebody sells the jewelry, any gain or loss arising out of that will be treated as capital gain or loss. Once again, I'm repeating, jewelry here is not sold by a jeweler or a jewelry company. For them, it would be stock in trade. That is not a capital asset. Stock in trade is never a capital asset. But jewelry which is held for personal purposes normally but sold is still treated as capital asset. It cannot be called as personal effect. Then what is jewelry? There is a big definition. We don't need that. Essence is enough. Jewelry not from our normal imagination. Whatever is shown in the advertisements, Lalita jewelry, Jayalalukas and all, of course that is jewelry. Anyway, it is jewelry. But not only that. Jewelry includes anything. Anything means anything. Not just what is actually worn by the SSE. Not necessarily. Anything made of gold, silver or platinum or any other precious metal or alloys thereof. So basically, jewelry does not mean what we think as jewelry. It includes that also, but it also includes literally anything that is made of gold, silver or platinum. Three metals are mentioned in the law, but the law cannot list down all the things, iridium, that, this and all. No, not possible. So what they might tell? Or any other precious metal or alloys thereof. Somebody may say, I have a mixed jewelry with gold and silver put together, it is not jewelry. No, we cannot say it is not jewelry, it is also jewelry. Even a mix of such metals also can be called as jewelry. And any item made of such alloys also is jewelry. So it includes anything, that is a very open-ended word, anything made of gold, silver or platinum or any other precious metal or alloys thereof. That is jewelry. And that is jewelry which is not personal effect, which means it is a capital asset. Then, second thing which is also not a personal effect but a capital asset is precious and semi-precious stones. Whether or not sewn into any jewelry, we can add that. But once again, whether they are sewn into jewelry, then automatically that is jewelry. Anyway, it is not a personal effect. Precious stones, loose stones are there, not the normal stones which are there on the road. We are talking precious stones. So many stones will be there, no? Like diamond, ruby, emerald, you know, various things are there like that. Those are all precious stones or even semi-precious stones. We don't need to know the list of what is a precious stone, what is a semi-precious stone. We are not going to do any jewelry business here and we don't need to know that also. Technically, we are not gemologists or somebody. We don't need to be. What law told, the essence of it, we have to understand. What law is intending here? Jewelry is that thing, anything that is made of gold, silver or platinum or any other precious metal, any other metal or even alloys of those metals also can be called as jewelry. Precious and semi-precious stones is also jewelry, loose also, or sewn into jewelry also. That is also not a personal effect, which means that is a capital asset. Somebody sells diamonds, makes a profit or loss, definitely that is capital gain. Once again, always you have to keep that in mind. Somebody sells a diamond means not a diamond merchant selling diamond. Diamond merchant selling diamonds, that is stock and trade for him. That is different. That will be PGBP. But the same diamonds, if sold by another person who for whom diamonds are not stock and trade, then it becomes a capital asset. It is not a personal effect. Nobody can claim that jewelry and these precious stones or semi-precious stones or semi-precious or precious metals and ornaments or any other things made of these metals as personal effects. That is not possible because those are not considered as personal effects and hence they are considered as capital assets. Same way, archaeological collections are capital assets. Archaeological collections means some old excavations, something has come out as a small idol or some other coins, old coins might come out. Of course, it is illegal to hold them. We have to give it to the government, unlike movies. Our reality is that it is illegal to hold them. But whatever, still, if you found any of such archaeological collections, old things like that, if that is sold, a lot of money might be coming to the SSE. That is taxable as capital gains because archaeological collections cannot be told as, they cannot be called as personal effects, which means they are capital assets. Same way, drawings, paintings, any other sculptures or any other work of art, these things cannot be called as personal effects. Those are capital assets. M.F. Hussain, now he is not there anyway. Example, let us say M.F. Hussain is not there, but his paintings are there. Somebody who purchased an M.F. Hussain painting, say 10 years back, for 1 crore rupees then, now probably if he sells the same painting, he might get some 10 to 15 crores rupees. Paintings and drawings also are a kind of investments at a very high level, people. So if they sell that, now they made, let us say, 9 crores profit, just for calculation, understanding purposes. Should that be taxable or not? Of course, yes. Can the person say, "Arey, this was my personal effect. This painting was there in my bedroom for 10 years. I used to enjoy that. I used to always get lot of motivation from this painting." Whatever the nonsense he tells, all those things are useless. Why? Because it cannot be called as personal effect. It is not a personal effect. Drawings, paintings, sculptures, or for that matter any work of art cannot be called as personal effects. Those are capital assets. Those are all taxable in the sense, if they are holding them is not taxable. people again get wrong impression. There is one businessman who has 10,000 diamonds with him. So should we tax him now for that? No, we are not doing that. It is not wealth tax. When he sells any of them, when he gets gain or loss out of them, then we will tax it. That is what is income tax. For income tax to be levied, that is why the definition or charging section itself told there should be a capital asset and there should be a transfer. Without a transfer, there is nothing that is taxable. But before going to the word transfer, first we are looking at what is a capital asset. Capital asset is property of any kind held by the SSE, whether or not connected with the business or profession. But stock in trade and personal effects are not called as capital assets. These are exceptions to the definition of capital asset. One is stock in trade, other one is personal effects. But there is an exception to the exception of personal effects, which means all the following items are treated as capital assets. These are inclusions like what? Jewelry, precious or semi-precious stones, archaeological collections, drawings, sculptures, paintings, or any work of art. These are all capital assets, which are not personal effects. They cannot be claimed as personal effects. They will be considered as capital assets only. Now let us go back to the exceptions list. Rural agricultural land is not a capital asset. Already, if we know this, agricultural land, rural and urban definition, which is there in the topic of agricultural income also, same logic applies here. Rural agricultural land, urban agricultural land, classification becomes important. Okay, in the chapter of agricultural income, that was important to identify whether the farmhouse which is situated in an urban area or a rural area, whether the income from such house property is taxable or not. For that particular purpose, rural agriculture classification was important in that chapter of agricultural income. But the same classification is important here also, where rural agricultural land is not a capital asset. In other words, if anybody sells a rural agricultural land, there is nothing that is taxable because it is not even a capital asset. So zero taxability, we can say completely. In other words, effectively exempt from tax. Not like specifically exempt from tax. Effectively, that's what it is. When you say it is not a capital asset at all, then how can there be any taxability of that? That itself is gone. So for the simple understanding, if the agricultural land, which is a rural agricultural land, is sold by anybody in the rural areas, nothing is taxable. Zero income tax they have to pay on the capital gain, if at all they have any gain also. So that is a very important point, but unfortunately a lot of people don't know this. They don't know this and they think that is all black money, and they think that is all illegal money, and they will be very afraid of that cash what they hold in the rural areas, because they are most of the times not so literate. And even literate people also are not necessarily tax literate. So they are afraid of that. But point is here, rural agricultural land. Rural agricultural land definition will not be according to our own whims and fancies of, okay, ours is a very rural area, so it is a rural agricultural land. No, 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 not like that. This definition is there already in the agricultural income chapter also. Here also it is same. What is not a rural agricultural land? What is not a rural agricultural land, and hence which will be considered as capital asset? That depends upon the population of the municipality or a cantonment board with a population of how much, and this land is situated where. If the land is situated within the jurisdiction of a municipality or cantonment board with a population of more than 10,000, then it is not a rural agricultural land, which means it is a capital asset. Transfer of that could be taxable. Same way, if the land is situated within 2 kilometers from the local limits of a municipality or cantonment board with a population of more than 10,000 but not more than 1 lakh, then also it is a urban agricultural land. Same way, within 6 kilometers from the local limits, within 8 kilometers from the local limits of municipality or cantonment board with a population of between 1 lakh to 10 lakhs and more than 10 lakhs, within this jurisdiction it is urban. Outside this jurisdiction, it is rural. And this distance is aerial distance, by the way. Not the distance that we are going to measure by tape on the road. No, that distance is not relevant. Aerial distance. Sir, how do we know the distance? You don't have to worry about it. The revenue records, the government will have all these distance data. according to them, it will be not very difficult to identify what is a rural agricultural land or what is an urban agricultural land according to this definition. But care has to be taken. Just for example, certain thing is within just 100 meters below this local limits, just 50 meters only, sale of that asset could be highly taxable. Just 50 meters, 100 meters outside of this jurisdiction, then that sale of rural agriculture land could be completely exempt. So it becomes very important in real life, of course, for litigation purposes also. Huge difference can be there just within a distance of few feet or few meters, because absolutely this is aerial distance which will be naturally precise in nature. So according to these distances and the respective populations, rural agricultural land and urban agricultural land has to be classified. Sale of rural agricultural land is not at all taxable. Sale of urban agricultural land might be taxable, and we'll see particular provisions related to that later. But rural agricultural land already ruled out. Anybody selling a rural agricultural land is not taxable at all. Any sale of rural agricultural land and any amount of gain that is arising out of rural agricultural land is not at all taxable. Completely, that is outside the purview of Income Tax Act, one way we can say, because it is not salary, it is not income from house property, there is no house property, it is not PGBP, it is not capital gains because there is no capital asset itself. And we cannot just say because it is income from other sources because no head is attracted. If they wanted to really tax it, they would have anyway told that it will be taxable in capital gains only. Why would they exclude it from the capital gains? When urban agriculture land is capital asset, when the law clearly says rural agriculture land is not a capital asset, the intention of the law is what? Not to tax the gain or loss arising from sale of rural agricultural land. Imagine a big landlord has sold 100 crores worth of rural agricultural land, still 0 rupee tax he will pay. No taxation will be there on the sale of rural agricultural land. This is one of the other things that we have to keep in mind whenever we talk about, particularly, you know, number of taxpayers, tax to GDP ratio in this country. All these things are good, definitely statistically correct. But when we are saying that agricultural income is exempt and majority of the people in this country are dependent on agricultural income, that is exempt, there itself the population wise we are excluding more than 60% of, or maybe more than that including their dependents, 60 to 70% of the population is already excluded from the entire scope of Income Tax Act itself. And remaining people, they might not be having any incomes at all. Even if a small farmer or even a big landlord, whoever they may be, if they sell their agricultural land, which is a rural agricultural land, they don't have to pay any tax. There is no black money involved in that. They can get crores of rupees also, still they don't have to pay any tax. Unfortunately, as I said, a lot of people don't know this. This is something that particularly the rural people should know, because a lot of sad incidents happened, particularly during the demonetization time. Unfortunate incidents happened. I was almost not a live spectator, but I was getting reported with that when I used to go to different TV channels to create awareness about what actually should people be doing and what people should not be afraid of. So what happens is, when certain things like demonetization are happening, people who are really supposed to be afraid of, those are all okay. Those are all finding ways for how to, you know, come out of this. And the people who really don't have to worry, they are started worrying. They are all thinking some money, whatever they have in the form of old notes, that is a big, big problem for them. Or the cases, some of them, what I heard were very, very unfortunate cases. Literally, this call came from one of the rural areas of Telangana, where a couple, old couple, more than 60 years old couple, and their kith and kin are also not there. And that old couple had some small rural agricultural land, which was compulsorily acquired by the government for some of the projects that time, some of the irrigation projects. And government gave them a compensation. So that is also a capital gain, normally speaking. And they have received some huge compensation, reasonable amount of compensation. And along with that, they sold some adjacent land also, which also involved a few lakhs of rupees of transaction. I don't remember exact amount, but approximately something like 50 lakhs rupees worth of cash they had in their home. And we are talking about, once again, rural, illiterate, farming class of people, the two old people. Almost 50 lakhs rupees cash they have at home. And they suddenly came to know about this demonetization announcement. And what people were talking about is, whatever cash they had, that is useless. 500 notes and 1000 rupee notes are useless, they thought. Because that's what was told. Suddenly, both the people committed suicide. That this was really a very unfortunate event that really happened, and some of the members of their neighbors or somebody in that village have made a call to the TV studio where I was giving some kind of confidence to the rural people, particularly not to worry about any cash they have, not to worry about any transactions they did in the form of agricultural activities or in the form of sale of rural agricultural land. No need to worry. If you have 5 crores also, don't worry, go and deposit. Who will ask you? What is going to be a problem? Nothing is going to be a problem. Let the income tax department send the notice. We'll respond to that. No, but no problem. At the maximum, what happens? You may have to go to a proper chartered accountant who can draft a letter at least. Maximum, that will happen. We'll give him some few thousands of rupees or whatever the fees he wants. Or maybe a lot of chartered accountants will even do free if at all it is for a really a genuine case of a small farmer. Nobody is going to charge them. The point is, it's the fear factor which unnecessarily has peeped into many people, but unfortunate thing. The point is, the rural agricultural land sale does not attract capital gains tax, or for that matter any tax as far as central government, this income tax is concerned. Okay, when the properties are transferred, stamp duty valuation will be there, local state government will have stamp duty value, which is called stamp duty. That tax will be levied by state government locally. That is a different story. That will be very small percentage of the value. No income tax is leviable on the incomes that are generated by sale of rural agriculture land. Why is that? Just because the law itself excluded it from the definition of capital asset. Outright. Gone. So no taxation is there for rural agricultural land transfer. That's a very important point to be noted. And if at all, anyone whom we encounter doesn't know this and are thinking about rural agricultural land also is taxable, we can create awareness to them. But once again, a lot of times it so happens people think that their land is rural agricultural land. No, sir. There is not rural agricultural land automatically. It will be the aerial distance which is measured within the 2 kilometers, 6 kilometers or 8 kilometers from the local limits of a municipality or cantonment board. That distance of 2 kilometers, 6 kilometers, 8 kilometers is measured aerial distance. So a lot of times it so happens in the vicinity of nearby areas of any big city or even in a small municipality or a town also, most of the lands will be urban agriculture lands by this definition. On one side, rural agriculture land is not taxable, transfer of that. On another side, urban agriculture land, if it is, that is taxable. That also people don't know. A lot of people just sell the urban agriculture land and keep quiet without paying any capital gain tax. Then they will get notice, of course, other proceedings will be initiated against them. But the point is about the classification of rural and urban agriculture land is so important that just one difference is going to create a lot of possible options in relation to one taxability, the other one completely taxable, other one is completely not taxable, like that. So that much difference is there means that minute difference also becomes very crucial. Anyway, what is the essence of all this is, stock in trade is not a capital asset, personal effects are not a capital asset except jewelry, etc. Rural agricultural land is not a capital asset, that means these are all not taxable. When there is a sale of them, these are not taxable under this head of income, for sure. Stock in trade, personal effects are not at all taxable. Personal effects and rural agricultural land are not at all taxable. Stock in trade, if it is sold, it will be taxable in PGPP. These things are not taxable also, which are mentioned in the fourth point. Gold bonds, special bearer bonds, gold deposit bonds issued under respective schemes by central government. Those are excluded from the definition of capital asset because we can call them as tax-free bonds. Even if they are sold also, even if there is any tax, in other words, capital gain also on them, it is not taxable because government itself promised the investors when it issued these bonds that these bonds will be tax-free bonds. In other words, no capital gains tax will be there on the sale or transfer of those bonds. Not every bond, you have to remember these names. Gold bonds, special bearer bonds, gold deposit bonds issued under the respective schemes by central government. These are all government bonds. And government issues many types of bonds, thousands of types of bonds will be there. We are not talking about all of them. Only those bonds which are specifically excluded from the definition of capital assets, those bonds only will be not considered as capital asset, which means if they are transferred also, sold also, there is no tax that is payable on them. That is completely excluded from the definition of capital asset and from the purview of the head of capital gains also, naturally. So the intention here is very clear. Personal effects not to be taxed at all. Rural agricultural land not to be taxed at all. Gold bonds, special bearer bonds, gold deposit bonds not to be taxed at all. Stock in trade will be taxed if it is sold, but not under capital gains, but under PGBP. That is the essence of definition of capital asset and what is not a capital asset also. Now moving on to some of the court cases or some of the points to be noted, which also might be somewhere appearing in the questions. Once again, these are mostly the court cases, judgments. We don't need to know the case, which case it is, but in general, we can just remember them at a broader level. Gold and silver coins used for puja are capital assets. So somebody was having gold coins, silver coins, which they used in their puja room to, worship the gods within their puja room. That gold coins they sold and they said, those are my personal effects. Court said, no, no, Baba, those are capital assets. Those transfer of them will be taxable. But on the other side, there is one more variety judgment where kitchen and dining silver utensils are not capital assets. Why and all, you cannot ask. Court said that. What we can do? Logically speaking, they should be capital assets because they are made of silver. But court gave an exception. Act gave some exceptions. Court gave another exception. Court said what? Don't worry, silver utensils and all, we cannot consider them as capital assets. So that means silver utensils, which are particularly kitchen or dining silver utensils, if they are sold also, there is no taxability of them. A lot of affluent families, and even not only affluent, even a lot of middle class families also traditionally use silver utensils for their dining. A lot of people still eat their lunch or dinner in the silver plates. That is not a capital asset as per court. So it is not a capital asset. Then, membership of a stock exchange is a property and hence it is a capital asset. Somebody who is a member of a stock exchange, that membership card itself can be sold. So court said definitely it is a capital asset because it is a property. Then another important point, right to acquire a property is also a capital asset. Property itself need not be a capital asset. It is anyway a capital asset. Right to acquire a property is also a capital asset. Sometimes there may not be any property as such, but there may be a right to acquire a property. That right also is a capital asset. Classic example of that, of course, though it is exempted, when can it be exempted separately under the head of capital gains? First of all, it should be capital asset, no? Then only exemption can be given later. Rural agricultural land and all, there is no exemption. It is anyway not a capital asset. It is already excluded from the definition of capital asset. Personal effects, stock in trade, gold bonds, etc. These are not like exempted incomes. Those are excluded from the definition of capital asset itself. But particularly one category where exemption is given separately for this particular case, which is a unique case related to the lands of the proposed capital region of Andhra Pradesh state, which has been formed somewhere in 2014 separately after getting split into two states of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. After the split, Telangana, of course, already had Hyderabad as its capital, but Andhra Pradesh supposed to develop a capital at that time, which was decided to be Amaravati. So we'll continue the same name. As we are speaking now, that is completely doubtful whether Amaravati will continue to be the only capital of Andhra Pradesh or not. Let us not get into those political things. So much of confusion is there on that. Well, let us focus on tax things, and we are not doing any creative taxation. It is there in the law. So we are talking about it. Because this is a unique situation also. And a live and real life example in front of us also. So what the Amaravati was originally planned like? Amaravati was planned with this model, wherein the state government has pooled the land, not acquired the land. There are two different things, land acquisition and new thing which was invented freshly, which never was there almost in the entire country, is land pooling. Land acquisition is different, where the government will acquire the land, it will give some compensation to the owners of the land, as good as government purchasing the land from the owners compulsorily. But only difference there is, government, if it wants the land of a person, the person cannot say, no, I will not sell you. For an individual private parties, if X asks the land of Y and Y says no to X, X cannot kabja the land of Y. Not possible. If it is there, then that becomes illegal and X becomes a kabjakor, land grabber. But government can do that. Government, we cannot call it kabjakor or land grabber. It has its power. Government, state or central government, whatever it is, they can acquire the land also, any other property also, from the citizens compulsorily. Of course, not without compensation. They have to give money. Whatever the money that is prescribed by them, they will give it. There, that is compulsory acquisition. We'll come to that also later. But in this case of Amaravati, what happened is, the farmers, so many of them, hundreds of them or thousands of them, gave up their lands to the government. And government did not give the farmers 1 rupee also while taking land from those farmers. Then what the farmers got? Okay, now we can say they got only cheating. It's a different story. But when the farmers actually gave up the land and what was the consideration for that? They got a right to acquire a property in the developed land, which will be developed after whatever X number of years. In that developed land, the farmers will get a particular amount of area of land. So when they gave up this agricultural land, whatever it is, mostly agricultural land, that is what they give up. And what they got as a in return of that is not a land itself. That will come in future. Immediately what they got? They got a piece of paper which says, boss, because you have, let us say, sacrificed or gave, sacrifice is a bad word, you gave 1 acre of land, after X number of years, once this entire city or Amaravati, whatever the dream capital is developed, then you will get so and so square yards of developed land. Different equations are there. Somebody will get, say, 1200 yards per acre that they have given up. Somebody may get 800 yards. Somebody may get 700 yards. Something like that. Some calculations are there. We don't need to go into that. But look at the essence of the transaction. The farmer is giving up 1 acre. What is getting in return? He's giving up land and getting a land. But is he getting land now? No. He's only getting a right to get a land in future. So that's what is a right to acquire property. That piece of paper, what the farmer has got, can he sell that piece of paper? That piece of paper is not a land. That is not a land document. That is a document which gives the farmer a right to acquire the land in future, when the allotment actually happens. Of course, looks like allotments also happened in the recent past. But initially, the moment when they have given up their original agricultural lands, what they got in return of that was immediately a piece of paper which gives them a right to acquire a property in future. So the point is that right to acquire a property is also a capital asset. Can they sell that piece of paper? They sold, actually a lot of farmers already sold also that piece of paper, which was a right to acquire a property. So the developed land, which is not yet available, which might be available in future, is already sold before even it is being allotted to the farmers. It's a different story. If they sold it, that is not a taxable item because of an exemption that is given separately by another section. We'll come to that later. But the question is, why exemption is first of all given? Because basically it is taxable. Why basically it is taxable? Because right to acquire a property is also a capital asset. So capital asset itself need not be a capital asset. Even right to acquire a property also is a capital asset. That's a very important, interesting point related to what is a capital asset. Physical property need not be there. If there is a paper or anything else which is conferring the SSE a right to acquire a property, that is also a capital asset. So just for understanding, not that really it is. Like there is a old Telugu movie Kshanakshanam, in which there will be a token or a slip which is related to a railway clock room. So there is a bag in railway clock room, and there is a clock room receipt, railway clock room receipt, and there is a, let us say, 1 crore rupees of cash in that bag. Okay, instead of cash it could be gold or anything also, just for example. So the point is, if somebody sells that one railway clock room receipt, that piece of paper, so is that a capital asset? That piece of paper is a capital asset or not? Yes, it is a capital asset, because it is right to acquire a property. Of course, cash is not a capital asset. So cash, to get cash, is not a transaction at all. But imagine in that bag there is gold, and somebody sold this gold which is stored in the railway clock room with a receipt, and that receipt is the right to acquire that property in the form of gold which is stored in a bag which is placed in railway clock room. So for understanding purposes, these things only are mentioned, not that really it happens. These are all criminal things what we are talking about. Keeping in clock room gold and all is criminal. It is not going to be normally correct. But for understanding, simple way of understanding what is a right to acquire property, that can be just useful. Anything which is conferring the SSE a right to acquire a property definitely becomes a capital asset. That can be sold also, and any sale of that also will become taxable under the head of capital gains. That's a very important point. Why it becomes important is, it is abstract. It is not clear. In case there is a land, somebody sold it, very clear. Gold is there, sold it, very clear, no problem. So there is a property that is sold, it is capital asset, and it is transferred, means there is capital gain. Those are clear transactions. Certain times there will be transactions which are not so clear. There will be abstract transactions. Particularly in this chapter of capital gains, we will encounter many of such things in future also. So you need to be very clear in understanding the essence, logic, and intention of the statute very much in this chapter, more than just a few provisions. Provisions will be anyway very less. But the intention of the statute is very important to understand in this particular chapter. Logic has to be understood very importantly. Now, another point to be noted is, the precious or semi-precious stones are always capital assets, whether or not they are sewn into any wearing apparel or furniture or any utensil. So if they are sewn into any wearing apparel also, they are capital assets. If they are not sewn into and they are in the form of, let us say, loose diamonds or something, those are also capital assets. Once again, if you go back to the definition of jewelry, jewelry includes anything that is made of gold, silver, platinum, or any other precious or precious metal or alloys thereof. Within that jewelry, if there is some diamonds shredded into that, that is also jewelry. Let us say there is somebody who has a coat for which the buttons are all made of diamond. Is that coat a jewelry? Of course, yes, it is jewelry also. Jewelry does not mean only necklaces and all, or rings and what we know as jewelry. That includes anything that is made of gold, silver, or platinum, or any other precious metal or alloys thereof. And precious and semi-precious stones will be jewelry, they will be capital assets, whether or not they are sewn into any wearing apparel or any furniture or any utensil. So if somebody has a silver spoon only, which is actually used for, you know, dining purposes, but that is studded with diamonds, can you say that it is not a capital asset because silver utensils are not capital asset? No, that is a capital asset because there are precious or semi-precious stones in that. So if there is any jewelry or any item for that matter which has precious or semi-precious stones, that will be always a capital asset. Just for imaginations, somebody has a pen which has a diamond tip, it is a capital asset, it is jewelry, as good as jewelry. or somebody has a spectacles which is made of gold, gold frame, not gold plated and gold coated, gold, really gold frame. A lot of people use that. I mean, top level, highly rich people. So, is that a capitalist asset? Yes, it is. Gold watch is a capitalist asset. Normal watch, however expensive it may be, it is not a capitalist asset. Why? Because it is a personal effect. Gold watch will become a capitalist asset automatically. So, that is where the watch, let us say a normal watch studded with certain precious or semi-precious metals, becomes a capital asset. Gold dustbin can be made. It is also a capital asset. Gold golden chair, like Simhasan, somebody made and sits on that, made of gold. It is heard that, we are not sure how true it is, from the media reports, Gali Janardhan Reddy used to have such type of golden things at his home. We don't know how far it is true. But if it is true, it is a capital asset. But that does not make Gali Janardhan Reddy any criminal. Holding them is not a problem. If he can prove that where he got money to buy them, then there is no problem. I am sure he would have proven that. That is why he is not having any conclusive crimes which are proven against him so far. In future, we have to see what happens. But the point is, that is jewelry. He had a golden dustbin, he had a golden simhasan type chair wherein he used to sit. This is all not furniture. That cannot be called furniture. That is a capital asset. That cannot be called as a personal effect. So these are the points to be noted. So simply speaking, we don't have to break our heads. Anything made of gold, silver, platinum, or any other precious metal, or alloys of precious metals, or precious or semi-precious stones, whether in loose or whether they are sewn into anything, everything of that is becoming definitely a capital asset that is taxable. If it is transferred, holding it is not taxable. If it is transferred, definitely that would be taxable. So far, there is no proof that Gali Janardhan Reddy has transferred it. So probably that would not have been taxable so far. We might be still using them. That we don't know. We don't need to know also. But the point to note here is capital asset definition, particularly which is made of precious metals and semi-precious metals, precious and semi-precious stones. That's it. Again, what is a precious metal? What is a semi-precious stone? Sir, will emerald also be called a semi-precious stone? Will the pearl be also a semi-precious stone? We don't have to go through that type of questions. Why? Because it is useless. That is not our intention here to discuss it. Just to know what are the things in general. We are not here once again to be jewelers or gemologists to get into what is precious, what is semi-precious, what are precious metals which are all possible to be used as making jewelry in this world. We don't need to know that. We need to know the law. To that extent, in general, we know most of the things, that is enough. We don't have to do any research on that. That will be a waste of time. That is the definition of capital asset, very important definition, because without the capital asset definition being fulfilled, the transfer of any asset is not going to be attracting the charging section of 45 itself. So, transfer is secondary. First of all, there should be capital asset. Okay, there is capital asset. Then what? Then that capital asset should be transferred. Then the law has also defined what is a transfer. Normally, what is a transfer under normal circumstances? Normally, sale. 90% of the cases, transfer means sale only. But is sale the only transfer? No. According to section 2, subsection 47, sale, exchange or relinquishment of an asset. Exchange means one asset given up, one asset taken up. That is also a transfer. Relinquishment of the asset or extinguishment of any rights in the asset. Both are similar. Relinquishment means giving up completely. Just like that, giving up the asset. That is also a transfer. Extinguishment of any rights in the asset also is giving up the rights in that asset. Relinquishing, extinguishing. Extinguishing means completely stopping the rights. Relinquishment means leaving it. Or giving up, simply speaking. That is also a transfer. So, it is a transfer. Already some people might be thinking it's all taxable. No. whether it is taxable or not will depend upon many factors. That should be a capital asset first of all, then of course it should be a transfer according to 247, and it should not fall under the definition of the transfers which are not regarded as transfer. There is a separate discussion on transactions which are not regarded as transfer. When they are not regarded as transfer, there is nothing taxable. When it is not even a capital asset, there is nothing taxable. So in order for the thing to be taxable, all these conditions have to be satisfied. We don't have to jump to the conclusions. We have to read the law carefully, what it says exactly to that extent. Sale, exchange, relinquishment of an asset is a transfer. Relinquishment includes somebody just gave an asset as a gift to another person. Is it a transfer? Yes, it is a transfer. To that extent, yes. What happens to that latter? We'll see that latter. For understanding purposes, is it a transfer? Basically, yes. What if that is excluded from the definition of transfer latter? Then we'll see that. But as the essence of the transaction, relinquishment of an asset or extinguishment of the rights in the asset, both of them are transfers. Compulsory acquisition of the asset under any law is also a transfer. As we just now discussed, government, if it compulsorily acquires any property of any person, that is also a transfer. The SSC cannot say there is no free consent, government has taken it from me forcefully, whatever you cry, that doesn't matter. It is a transfer, first of all. Once again, transfer does not mean automatically it is taxable. It should be a capital asset also, no? It should be capital asset also. Then it should be transferred also. And that should be transferred during the previous year also. For each of them, there are so many further additional conditions and further situations we have to test. So once again, we should not jump to conclusion. What we are looking at is what is transfer. That's all. That does not automatically make all of them taxable. Sometimes they may be, sometimes they may not be. That we will see according to each of those transactions when we encounter them in future. But this definition of transfer has to be remembered. Sale, exchange, relinquishment of an asset, extinguishment of any rights within that asset are therein. Compulsory acquisition of the asset under any law. Conversion of capital asset into stock in trade is also a transfer. Earlier we have seen the reverse of it in PGBP. Conversion of stock in trade into capital asset was charged under section 28 as PGBP. Now, reverse, conversion of capital asset into stock in trade is treated as transfer, and that will be taxable under the head of capital gains. The maturity or redemption of zero coupon bonds is also a transfer. Zero coupon bonds are those which will not carry any interest. They will be issued at a very deep discount and they will be redeemed after some time. At the time of maturity, is that a transfer? Yes, that is a transfer also. Maturity itself, it need not be sold separately. Maturity of the zero coupon bonds itself will be a transfer. For the transferor, who is the holder of zero coupon bonds? Of course, we discussed this earlier from the company point of view, from the issuer's point of view. From the issuer's point of view, the discount that is related to the zero coupon bonds should be amortized over the period of life of that bond. That was PGBP. Expenditure which is allowed as deduction in case of section 36, where issuer can claim a deduction. Now we are talking not about issuer, we are talking about investor. Investor purchased, let us say, zero coupon bond at 20 rupees. And after 10 years, 12 years, that bond is redeemed at 100 rupees. So this 80 rupees is his gain or not? Should this be transaction regarded as transfer or not? Of course, yes. So the maturity of or redemption of zero coupon bonds is also a transfer. Then, disposing of or parting with an asset or any interest thereon. General things already happened. General things. Any interest, disposing of or parting with, both are same. Relinquishment, extinguishment, disposing, parting with, all of them are same. Just different names. Creating any interest in any asset in any manner whatsoever. What else you want? When you say whatsoever, that creates everything. Creating any interest in any asset in any manner whatsoever means the transferor is creating any interest related to this asset to transferee. What manner? Any manner whatsoever. So everything is gone. We don't need the other things also. Anybody who is creating interest or ownership or whatever type of interest it is in favor of some other person in an asset in any manner whatsoever, that is called as transfer. So general things will be there. We cannot apply them practically speaking. Those will be just included in the law so that the coverage or the purview of the law is broader. But particularly what we should think about, each of them is a transaction. Sale is possible, exchange is possible, relinquishment of the asset, something like a gift or something, that can be also discussed later. Compulsory acquisition of capital assets is a separate transaction, we will discuss that later. Conversion of capital asset into stock and trade is a transfer, separate type of transaction, we will discuss that later. Maturity, with nothing to discuss, that is a transfer, that is taxable, simple. So point is, these are the major things that are considered as transfer. Any way the asset or any interest within the asset is transferred to somebody or created in favor of somebody shall become a transfer according to section 247. So what is a capital asset? We have known that. What is a transfer? We have known that now. And when there is a capital asset that is transferred during the previous year, then any gain or loss arising from that transfer is subjected to tax under the head of capital gains. That's what section 45, which is the charging section of capital gains, has told us. But the story is not over. Once the capital asset we have known, whether it is a capital asset or not, we need to also look at whether that capital asset is a short-term capital asset or a long-term capital asset. Why is that? Because if the asset is a short-term capital asset, the gain or loss resulting from that will be called a short-term capital gain or short-term capital loss. If the asset is a long-term capital asset, gain or loss resulting from that will be called as long-term capital gain or long-term capital loss. So what is the important point here to note is whether a particular asset is a short-term capital asset or a long-term capital asset. There are three categories where we have to look at. There is one category where we have to look at the period of 12 months, another category where we have to look at a period of 24 months, and another category where we have to look at a period of 36 months. What is the generic category? Let us start from the below. Basically, any capital asset, we have to look at 36 months only. In other words, what? If an asset is held for 36 months or less than 36 months, then it will be a short-term capital asset. If an asset is held for more than 36 months, it is called as long-term capital asset. What is this 36 months? Called as period of holding. The SSE, before he transferred this asset, how many months he had held it previously? If he has held it for 36 months or more, it will be automatically a long-term capital asset irrespective of whatever it is, because this is a very generic thing applicable to all types of assets. But particular things are there where this 36 months principle is not applicable. In certain cases, 12 months is applicable. In certain cases, 24 months is applicable. Those are actually exceptions. What are those? Let us see. For example, if there is a security other than a unit which is listed in a recognized stock exchange, we can call that listed securities, then the period of holding for the purpose of computing whether it is a short-term capital asset or long-term capital asset will be 12 months. So listed securities, 12 months is the period. What are the security maybe other than a unit? Same way, units of equity-oriented fund, fund means mutual fund, or units of UTI, UTI means Unit Trust of India. Any units of them, but not any kind of mutual fund, equity-oriented fund. So units of equity-oriented fund also will be called as long-term capital assets if they are held for more than 12 months, that is enough. Same way, zero-coupon bonds are called as long-term capital assets if they are held for more than 12 months. These are the three things where the 12 months period is applicable for determining whether that asset is a short-term capital asset or a long-term capital asset. What are those? Listed securities, units of an equity-oriented fund or units of UTI, zero coupon bond. These are the three types of, all of them financial instruments. Period of holding for them is 12 months. More than 12 months, it is long-term capital asset. 12 months or less than 12 months. Even up to 12 months also exactly, it is a short-term capital asset. Then, coming to the unlisted shares. Unlisted what? Not unlisted all securities. Shares only. Unlisted shares and land or building or both, we can call them immovable properties. So immovable properties, land or building are immovable properties, right? And unlisted shares. These two will have a period of holding requirement of 24 months for it to be called as long-term capital assets, more than 24 months. What are the two things here? Unlisted shares and land or building are both, which is immovable properties. 24 months is the period that we should check. More than 24 months long-term, less than or equal to 24 months short-term. Then what are all remaining in the 36 months? Units of a debt-oriented fund. Debt-oriented fund, it is not covered in 12 months thing, because 12 months thing covered only equity-oriented fund. So debt-oriented fund will be normal 36 months only. Same way, unlisted securities other than shares, because unlisted shares are covered in 24 months category. Other than shares, there may be other securities also which are unlisted. They are still falling in the category of 36 months. This list and categorization, we have to remember that very well. Normally, any asset will be a long-term capital asset if it is held for more than 36 months. But listed securities, units of equity-oriented mutual fund or units of UTI, and zero coupon bonds will be called as long-term capital assets if they are held for more than 12 months. Same way, unlisted shares, not any securities, unlisted shares and immovable properties will be called as long-term capital assets if they are held for more than 24 months. And because those are not covered by 12 and 24 months earlier, units of debt-oriented mutual fund or unlisted securities other than shares will be also called as long-term capital assets if they are held for more than 36 months. These are the number of months of period of holding we need to find out whether a particular asset, which is a capital asset first of all, then if we want to categorize it into short-term or long-term capital asset, this period of holding has to be calculated according to this three different categories of assets. Let us just apply this in some of the examples in this exercise. Classify the following assets as long-term capital assets or short-term capital assets. Let us do that quickly. Listed equity share is there 35 months. Of course, it is a long-term capital asset. Why? Because I just put one thing, that is enough. Let us say L means long-term capital asset. Why? Because it is held for more than 12 months. That is enough. Listed preference share 11 months. Short-term capital asset. Because less than 12 months. Listed debenture 16 months. Look at this carefully. Listed debenture. So listed securities, all of them have this 12 months period only. The first category is what? Securities listed on a recognized stock exchange. Security could be anything. Share also, equity share also, preference share also, debenture also. If it is listed, 12 months criteria only will be there. That means it is long-term capital asset. Equity-oriented mutual fund, exactly 12 months. Exactly 12 months, it becomes short-term. If it exceeds 12 months, then only it becomes long-term. Unlisted equity share, 18 months, that is short term, because it is not held for 24 months. Now the category has changed. Unlisted equity shares, the category is 24 months category. So if it is held for less than 24 months, it is automatically short term capital asset. Land also, less than 24 months, short term capital asset. Residential building, more than 24 months, long term capital asset. Office car is not a capital asset. Don't go by just blindly. Office car, how can it be a capital asset? It is not a capital asset. It is a depreciable asset. Of course, it will be separately treated. We know that. But always, it will be having a short-term capital gain or loss only, because office car falls under the depreciable assets category. Depreciable assets also can be capital assets, but the way the capital gain or loss is calculated for depreciable assets is different, which we have already seen in the PGBP chapter. But what can arise out of that? Asset could be long-term, short-term, 36 months, 44 months, 280 months also, doesn't matter. Always the gain or loss arising from sale of a depreciable asset, if at all it comes under the purview of capital gains, it will be always short-term. But because the gain is short-term, we cannot say the capital asset is also short-term. So we cannot just classify it under this same way of classification or demarcation we are looking at now. So office car is not falling under all the regular things that we are looking at. Personal car is also not even a capital asset because it is a personal effect. Personal car, that is, it is not jewelry, it is not some other thing which falls under the category of capital assets. It is not a capital asset at all. So nothing to be classifying it. Zero coupon bonds, long term capital asset because it is held for more than 12 months. Urban agricultural land, long term capital asset because more than 24 months, land or buildings are both, immovable properties 24 months is the criteria. Rural agricultural land, once again, is not even a capital asset. So this one, and this one, we should not even look at them. Not required. Of course, office car, there is a possibility of capital gain or loss. I am not saying that it will not be there. But anyway, there is a different calculation. Always, the gain or loss will be short-term gain, capital gain or loss. So it has no direct relationship with the capital gains chapter. It is in conjunction with PGBP. The depreciable assets will have a separate type of treatment. We'll come to that later, which we have seen already. We'll just revise it once again later. But personal car is not at all a capital asset. Rural agricultural land is not at all a capital asset. So it doesn't matter how many months they are held. Even if there is transferred also, nothing is taxable. Jewelry, definitely long-term capital asset because it is held for more than 36 months. Units of ETA is also long-term capital asset because it is held for more than 12 months. So when we look at the holding period, which holding period criteria we have to apply, we should be very clear. There are only three categories. One is a 12 months category. Second one is a 24 months category. Third one is a open category, that is 36 months. That's all. According to that, a particular capital asset can be classified as either short-term capital asset or long-term capital asset. Then the question says, what is this unnecessarily doing to unnecessary complication, long-term, short-term, what is this nonsense, why are we doing this? What is the reason for bifurcation of capital gains into long-term and short-term capital gains? Because the tax rates for the long-term capital gain and short-term capital gains are different. We cannot say any capital gain is capital gain, what difference it makes, ultimately it is all taxable only now. Yes, it is taxable. Taxability is different. But the tax rates which are applicable for long-term capital gains and short-term capital gains, both are different. That is why classification of capital gains into short-term and long-term becomes very, very important. If the classification is wrong, naturally the applicable tax rates will be wrong, or naturally the tax liability calculation also will be wrong. That is a major final calculation. So that is why classification of the capital gains or bifurcation of the capital gains into long-term and short-term capital gains, and for that purpose classification of capital assets into short-term and long-term becomes a very crucial aspect in this particular chapter, because the rates of tax are different for short-term capital gains and long-term capital gains. With that, we'll conclude this introductory session of capital gains, and we'll continue with the discussion related to many important crucial provisions related to the capital gains chapter and head of income. Particularly, this chapter will have different types of transactions. Each type of transaction has a different type of treatment. So, for example, conversion of capital asset into stock and trade is a different type of transaction. We can discuss about that. Compulsory acquisition is a different type of transaction. Like that, insurance claim received when a capital asset was originally destroyed, demolished, etc. Then that is a different type of transaction. Like that, normal transaction is what here? If you have to only look at basic capital gains transaction, that is the simplest possible thing. Asset sold, sale proceeds, deduct the purchase price of the asset originally. Whatever the gain or loss is there, that is taxable, there ends the matter. But no, it is not like that. Not always the routine case of sale will be there. There could be gift, there could be compulsory acquisition, there could be conversion of capital asset into stock and trade, there could be assets which are lost by fire or some other accident on which the insurance proceeds have been received now. Like this, variety types of transactions can happen, liquidation of companies, etc. Each of them has its own treatment. So this chapter is all about looking at how to treat or how to calculate or compute the capital gains in each of those cases. Once again, as far as this chapter is concerned, this is also a logical type of chapter. If we understand the essence of it, it is going to be very easy. But unfortunately, the actual problems that we do in examinations is going to be mostly mechanical in nature, like income from house property, same format, same type of problems, repeated, mostly those will be mechanical, and same type of routine format and presentation will be there in this chapter, but that is from examination point of view. Learning point of view, it has a lot of exciting things, so many things which are of particularly high level and very much practical applications are there, though they may not be really useful in exams. But still, as learning this head of capital gains, as far as that is concerned, there are so many special situations which we have to look at, encounter and understand how the Income Tax Act prescribes the treatment of various things, how to calculate capital gains or losses under different circumstances. That will be the essence of this chapter in the upcoming classes. We will continue this discussion in the next session. Till then, take care. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.